You gotta handle the rock with flair and rhythm if you wanna be judged on wood grain and concrete courts in New York. This ain't no nickel and dime. It's Dribble N Dimes, where scoring never looked this good, I guarantee it. But was your reputation built from the playground up? Or did you call next and they took that ish? Or cause you weren't as fast as police and ambulance sirens? Or as loud as Mr. Softy Ice Cream? No. You see, this is New York City hoops in prime time. As beautiful as the skyline, it's Dribble N Dimes.
This is Manny Digital. Welcome to another episode of the Dribble N Dimes podcast. Yo, I'm in Connecticut, B. I came to Connecticut. I needed to get a sense of Connecticut ball. This is going to be our first true-to-life, born-and-bred Connecticut product that we're going to talk to today. But first, let me properly introduce my man. He is a Kolbe Cathedral High School graduate. He actually helped lead the group there to a state championship when he was coming out of there. He's a Bridgeport, Connecticut native. He operates the New England Supreme Basketball Academy. He's hooped both at the University of Connecticut and the University of Massachusetts, my alma mater, if you haven't known by now. And today he helps out as a juvenile detention officer here in Connecticut. He's done a lot for his community. He works diligently to take the platforms that he's had opportunities to be a part of and has created to enrich Connecticut culture and the basketball landscape here. My guest on the show right now is Mr. Marcus Cox.
How you doing? It's Marcus Cox.
Yeah, he's mad mellow smooth. Like, man. Yeah. Yo, you don't scream? You don't get crazy?
I do. Okay. All right. I do. I've always been known to keep it.
You low key?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. That's what's up.
But you know, I got that side.
But you a savage on a basketball court.
Definitely.
Still?
Yes. Not to that degree in my age group, you know.
But I'm saying
30 and over.
if we're comparing age brackets, would you consider yourself a dominant player at this age group?
Yeah, okay. I would. I mean, it's sinking down now because my knee's not getting any better. But
okay,
you know. Right. It's almost over, but I'm still here.
You know, that's interesting because, I'm just taking the label off this thing right quick because they ain't paying me no money. So, shout out to water bottle people everywhere. It's interesting you say that, and you say it like you're not afraid of like the end, right? Of playing.
No.
And granted, your professional exploits have probably passed you by now, but it's interesting because when your mind still can take you to places on the court that your body can't, it's a really hard thing. And speaking like a complete amateur, like that's hard for me.
Mm-hmm.
Getting up in age, we're very close in age.
Yeah,
you kind of just was like, yeah, you know, it's a wrap almost. Like,
yeah, I mean, when you start so young, and I think we had this conversation earlier talking about Zion. Like, I feel like sometimes you can get burnt out. I started probably about third, fourth grade, got real good in sixth grade, and started moving up. But I had a lot of injuries young. But back then, we played on concrete,
mm-hmm.
So concrete tore a lot of people's knees up.
Right,
these kids don't have to play on that anymore. We weren't knowledgeable about that
because they're on hardwood all the time.
Yeah, and I think when your body starts to wear down, and like my doctors told me, man, he was like, yeah, we know you don't love to play basketball still, but you might need a knee replacement. My father had two. He stopped playing at 40.
Okay, so your father was a hooper too.
Yeah, I'm the furthest who made it.
And I
didn't play my senior year. So my father clunked out his sophomore year. My uncle was real good. He clunked out his freshman year of college, all due to bad limbs, bad knees. So my
it's genetics.
My aunt, all of she played basketball, knees. You know what I mean? So
yeah, that's young Mr. Cox over here.
Yeah.
On the one and twos, if you haven't heard. Yo, that's crazy. So was it like obvious for you early? Like, was your dad telling you, look, this might not be a long thing?
No, never. You know, we don't think like that.
Okay.
But I did notice I wore a knee brace since damn near my freshman year. I started wearing like a brace here and there. I took it off.
Of high school?
Yeah. And I started just noticing, you know, my performance level was super high then because you're young.
Right.
And I think when I got to about my sophomore year after I left UConn, because I was having real bad knee problems. And when I left, and Lappas put me in the dunk contest, and I'm like, I'm in Night Madness, and I'm like, I start noticing, like, yo, I might not be able to be dunking like that no more.
So, what, you like warming up, trying to get ready?
Yeah, and when I first came to the school, God bless his soul, I don't know if you remember Ronnell Blizzard.
Nah, I don't.
He passed away, but he played with us.
Okay.
And
was there some accident that he was involved in, or it was some natural causes thing?
I think right now it was natural causes.
Okay. Nah, there was someone else that passed.
Yeah, his was natural causes.
Had an accident.
But with him, you know, he was about 6'9", 6'10". And I first got to the school, and I took off on the baseline. I'll never forget. And I dunked on him.
Mm-hmm.
And they were like, oh, I told you he got hops.
Wait, like nuts on the forehead type?
Like crazy.
Oh,
Like I surprised myself, but that was like my last, I knew.
Big dunk.
After that, my knee hurt so bad. And I said, oh my God.
So what, you landed and you was like, ow?
Like afterwards.
Oh, okay.
Just from taking off. Because you know, once you start, you know, you got to put your body into taking off.
Yeah. Actually, I don't know. I've never dunked in my life.
Well, yeah. Yeah, I tore my knee up.
I understand. I've just never experienced it. So obviously a big, I don't know, obviously, I want to actually ask you.
Mm-hmm.
Chris Smith is big out here.
Yeah, Chris Smith.
Yep, he kind of you follow kind of in his footsteps,
yep,
trajectory-wise.
Mentor, yep.
So when did that come into play? I figured there was a connection because of the path you also took.
Yeah, well, Chris always came back to the school, and back then it was my father went to the school, my uncle played for the school, so a lot of my family went there too.
Oh.
It was a guy named Walter Luckett. He was the first player ever to be on Sports Illustrated, who wound up going to Detroit Pistons. Then he had like a knee injury, so he wound up getting cut.
It's like a Bridgeport thing, baby.
Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah, so once Chris was the next after that, and Chris used to come to the school when I got real big. He wanted to talk to me about my decisions. At that time, I had Lappas was at Villanova.
Yep.
I had Virginia. Pete Gillen, I think, was there. Kansas wanted me bad. So I had my top four, like Kansas, and I think I had Rutgers, and I had
Was it? Who was?
UConn. I had UMass in there, too.
Okay.
And he came to the school, and he said, you know, I don't know if you should go to UConn. And I was just like, the whole school was like the principal was like, why would you tell him that?
Why would you say that?
And he was just like, no, because I think it's too close. You know what I'm saying? And my father, when he got on the phone with Roy Williams, he was just like, yo, like, he should go to Kansas. My father said it's further out. I think that he'd be more focused. I just think UConn is too close.
Hmm.
And I think it knocked me a little bit staying so close to home.
In retrospect, do you think going away would have made you more focused?
I think
on
definitely.
Getting the job done
for me, yeah, because you at that so? Point in time I would be we'll play on ABC against like say Arizona. It'd be a big game, you know, we'd always rated in the top 20, and after the game 9 o'clock I'm back home in
with
the club
homies.
Somewhere you know, in one of the clubs coming back this way. Mm-hmm. You know, going New Haven, you know, going, you know, so it was just going back to Bridgeport, going to Milford. It was just like, why are you coming home so much? And it started, you know, I can get home quick.
Yeah,
and
right
a lot of people, went to from, you know, from CT was at UConn.
Mm-hmm.
So I get a ride home real quick, you know, and then once I got a car, that was it. I was back and forth, and it really messed me up because my focus. We had kids that was from Oklahoma, from like further away, that could stay at school and be focused. They didn't have nobody, you know, coming to get them, no distractions.
It's interesting because it could also go the other way, right?
Mm-hmm.
So like you go far away from home, the amount of independence you now have, a lot of college kids have a tough time managing that, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But you think you would have done better than it turned out.
Hey, me, my father talked about it all the time. He was just like, you know, and I was just like, I'm not going away to Kansas. You know, at that time, UConn just won the championship.
Right, yeah.
You know, we were top three recruiting class. I was in the top five or six point guards in the country. I'm like, man, I'm going. Okay, I'm getting all that love. I'm going to UConn. I didn't care what Chris came to talk to me. I was like, I'm going. Everybody knew I've been a UConn fan since little. Forever. Me and my father, we watched UConn, Ray Allen, Ricky Moore, Rashmo, my boy Rashmo Jones. You know, me and Khalid is still tight, me and L.I. Ming. So, no, I was a UConn fan, man.
It's crazy because, I mean, if we fast forward through your collegiate career, I mentioned at the Open you went both to UConn and to UMass. But you're still very closely associated with UConn, even though to somebody like me, not understanding the dynamics of why that decision happened, it's almost like Judas, right? Like you could kind of look at it that way. Like you abandoned one place,
yeah.
And I want to get into the reasons why. I think I understand, but you're really tight with UConn to this day.
Like, yeah,
people associate you almost like if you went there 4 years and. And that's kind of what you're known for, being a local product.
And I used to make a big thing out of that. Like, I went to UMass, too. Like, it's UMass.
Right, right.
When I was leaving UConn, it was such a big thing. Because
for you or
Calhoun,
for people?
Like, was just like, you really going to go to UMass? That was our rival. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so
I know.
He was like, you know, he did not. He wanted me to stay. But at that point in time, I still had all these schools that wanted me. So I said, I got to go somewhere and start. Like, Ben Gordon was coming in, which is my guy. And
Talik Brown was coming in.
You know, and once me and Talik got in that battle and I started, we started together. You know what I mean? Then, I started a couple games and then we went, you know, I think that a lot of politics played into it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, my playing time got shortened. So I was like, man, I got all these tons of schools that still want me. Plus, I had gotten, you know, a little bit of stuff. So after that, I was just like, I'm going to go to UMass. And they had a fit. I remember Karan Butler was just like, my boy Karan was just like, we were going at it. He's calling me a traitor. I was like, whoa.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. For the person on the outside, absolutely. And we get it. Like, yo, this overloaded with guards. They were overloaded with guards.
Yeah.
And then you had an incoming class behind you that was, you know, coming strong.
Mm-hmm.
So I get it. Like, it's a lot of competition for just a couple of spots.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's like, damn, dog. Like, this is home. So it's really difficult for them to understand. But so can you take us through what happened and why? I mean, the details. I think I covered, like, the generalities of it.
You said going from UConn to UMass?
Yeah, like, why did you make that decision?
Well, it was a lot of schools that were still on me at that point. And, you know, at the end of the year, we have our
your
discussions.
Your second year.
Yeah, after the year, you know, we have our discussions about, you know, basically what your future is going to be at the school. You know, we talk and, you know, make a decision. So Calhoun was just basically like, you know, the starting spot is yours. Like, this is yours. You know, Talik is younger than you. You know, you've been here. You know, I remember Khalid called me down to the office for him to talk to me. So I'm thinking, like, all right. So I stayed at school the whole summer, you know, and thought it was going to be a good year. You know, the politics came in many different aspects, which I won't talk about, but a lot of different politics came in. And when I put up that I was transferring, Virginia, Providence, UMass, the schools are still flooding. You know what I'm saying? Kansas still calling. So I'm like, hold up.
Hold on. Backtrack a second. So when you say you put it up.
Meaning you announced that you're transferring.
Okay. So what? You call the press? Like, how does that work?
Yeah, when you're at a big time school and big time player, like whatever you do, you got to go to the press.
Got it.
I had to announce it in the paper.
And that was like sanctioned. Like it was something that you said to Coach Calhoun, hey, look.
We talked, and that's why me and that's the reason, you know, we're cool to this day, because Calhoun becomes like, he was like a dad.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, Calhoun, no matter if you left the school, to him, he was like, you're always UConn to me. You know what I mean? Because he'd been recruiting me since sophomore year in high school.
Mm.
I mean, he was coming to my games to come and get me. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
So everybody always branded me as UConn.
Right.
So, you know, we had a real talk, man, and I was just like, you know, I got to go somewhere and play, coach, and I want to start. And he was like, I understand, because he couldn't promise me that I wouldn't have to split minutes with everybody.
Yo, that's a man's man right there.
Yeah.
Both of y'all.
And he was like, you're too good. So I was going to UMass. I was, I think I was Dick Vitale, top five transfers.
I know.
Then going into UMass, they had me like newcomer of the year or something like that. So it was just like
the hype train was heavy.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it was like, you know, still agents, you know, hey, we can get you into the draft, you know, everything is looking good. But, you know, me having, you know, sent out that year, my father told me, he said, I feel like you don't work out enough. He was like, if you sit out this year, it could hurt you. And he's like, you sure you don't want to stay at UConn? And I was like, nah, I'm out with that. You know what I'm saying? And that year hurt me. When I tell you that I became a student and I still was practicing with the team, but when you're not playing in them games and you ain't got the responsibility to be there at all times, you become like a
you
student.
You get lackadaisical about
it. Yeah, and I think that year did kind of tarnish me.
So instead of you doubling down on getting prepared for the following year where you can play, you kind of just did the bare minimum.
Bare minimum.
Got it.
Bare minimum. And my talent was so long because I was so good with my talent for so many years that
I just rested on that.
I can go out there and still do what I do. Right. You know, but but my father told me, like, that's only going to go but so far because you have to put the work in. And I understand it now.
Of course.
This is what I preach to these kids. You know what I'm saying? My little cousin's at Kolbe now, Ty, and he's like, yeah, I got him playing like a monster now, me and his father. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, just things like that.
In retrospect is a hell of a tool. Right?
Yeah, it really is.
But so your father's telling you all this stuff, and I know your coaches have said this, publicly stated, like, I think he could work harder if we push him more. Like, and I'm sure that there was some contention with you and your coaches at some point because, like, you can only push a button so many times. Mm-hmm. Was there ever any, like, real fallouts, any, like, you know, battles between you and the coaching staff when they're trying to push your excellence?
I was very confrontational. I was very confrontational at that point, meaning I just didn't want to. Being so young and mature, like, you don't want somebody to keep bothering. Yeah. So I would get very defensive about it, and we'll wind up arguing sometimes. And, you know, coaches always tell me, man, you just got to listen sometimes. You just got to pay attention and listen. Stop trying to be so stubborn and defensive. And I think that happened with me throughout college.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And if I would have sat back and would have listened more, it would have been better. When I went to UMass, Lappas was kind of the opposite, where I felt like he let me get away with some stuff. You know what I'm saying? So I think he kind of spoiled me. Yeah. So now when he did start coming at me, it was more or less.
Oh, you weren't expecting it.
Yeah,
he
so
didn't condition you that way.
So we had a game at Fordham, and in the game at Fordham, I remember my family came and Smush Parker was there, and we playing against Smush, and I really wanted to, you know, get at Smush. So
yeah, you're the second person. I was talking to, this gentleman.
You're a good dude. Smush talking like, you know, he talking
like, yeah. So you want to get at him.
So I was like, I'm going. And plus, you know, being at that time, because Bob Hill wanted me to go there and play with them. It was my guy Jeff was there, and it was Smush was there, and they had another player there. And Bob Hill was preaching in my transfer, you know, I can get you into the league. Which you see, he got Smush into the league. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
So I'm like, damn, like, how you did it? But, you know, Lappas, I think I made like two mistakes, or I missed a layup or something. What's going on? And Lappas.
He's not feeling your layups.
and Lappas took me out the game. And I just walked straight
this
to the locker
at
room.
At Fordham, this Fordham game.
At Fordham.
Okay.
And I just walked to the locker room.
Oh,
so once
like you skipped sitting down on the bench.
Yeah, like I just got up. So then they came and talked to me, and they said you need to come out of the locker room. So I'm like, come out the locker room. I'm like, man, I don't want to go out there. So I got back on the bench. So we get down to the to halftime now, and I'm just sitting there. You can't tell me nothing. I'm blacking out. So I'm sitting there like, why am I blacking out? Like, he got me this mad. You know, my family here, you gonna embarrass me. You know, it's a big game. You know what I mean? And it's like that school wanted you. So it was just a lot of different things going through my head. And I just wind up going bananas and picked the chair up. And they grabbed me. He looked at me like,
you're
really?
Wildin'.
And I was just like, fuck, I don't care. The coaches, they said, please stop. I'm like, nah, I don't care. Like, I just want to get out of here. Like, you know, I don't want to be here no more. And I think that's when, like, you know, everything started, like, looking down. Because I was starting at the beginning of the year.
Yeah.
So now.
This was in-game, on the court.
Yeah.
You bugged out.
Yep, I bugged out. So my parents, you know, my father looking at me. And now I'm embarrassed. You know what I mean?
Right.
So I get back on the bus. We don't talk. And I get back. And then we have a meeting. And, you know, he came to me. He was like, man, you know, what's the problem, man? Like, is that serious that you want to, like, you feel like this? And I just feel like, you just jerking me now. Like, you bought me over. You know, I came with you. I gave you, you know, a second shot. When you was at Nova, I didn't go. And I said, once, you know, I'm going to give Lappas that second shot. So, you know, I was real frustrated, but, you know, we got through it. And I wound up starting towards, like, the rest of the year. You know what I mean?
Until that's,
I got
yo, that's I'm thinking, if I'm Lappas, right, and you do that, I'm going to have to bug out. You want to time out?
Yeah.
I'm really shocked that Lappas was able to be so professional with a situation like that.
I think because he never, I wasn't that type of kid. So I think for him, it was just like,
it was like, out of character.
Whoa. I really messed him up like this. You know what I'm saying? Like, right. I really feel like that's what it was.
So you felt like he was like taking a little bit of, he was shocked because he didn't think he was going as hard potentially as it might have affected you?
Mm-hmm.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah. Come on, Papa.
It's all good. Hey, for those of you listening and you don't have kids, take this as an example. Us dads, we got stuff we got to deal with.
Yes, right?
We
do.
Trying to get things done.
Oh.
But it's the most amazing ride you'll ever go on. Trust me. Yeah. Cool. So you get back to UMass,
mm-hmm.
And you guys have a meeting.
Yeah.
And so you express to him like what you why he's falling short of the expectations apparently he set for you.
Yeah.
And then what happens after that?
After that, I picked it up. I mean,
so he just went under the bridge for him? Like, what was?
Yeah, you know, I think because we knew each other for so long and we developed a relationship, it was just like, you know what? You know, I know he ain't that type of kid.
Okay.
I'm going to just, you know, give him another shot to see, you know, what he does with it. And it picked me up. I was rebounding like crazy, playing hard, got back in the starting lineup, you know, because that beginning of that year, I played so well in Maui. And, you know, and
you stunting on me right now?
Huh?
You stunting on me right now?
No,
playing so well in Maui.
No. I said I played so well in Maui that I just felt like it's going to be a great year. And then I think maybe the fourth game of the season. Remember Troy Bell?
From Boston College, after me.
He torched us. You know, they had him. They had a couple other kids. He wound up going to the NBA with this other kid, but they torched us. And okay. After that, it started going like downhill. I think the team's confidence. You know
okay.
What I'm saying? So, but Lap's a good dude, though, man. He's a good dude.
That's what's up. I mean, I hear good things.
Mm-hmm. Here.
So that was your first year at UMass?
Yep, that's my first year playing at UMass. UMass, I sat out.
Right.
I sat out.
So how does it work? Because technically speaking, you did 5 years of university time before eligible years of playing time.
That's how it goes. You get 4 years.
So did you made it through the last season? Your
no.
senior season?
Okay. Oh, so what happened was, so my junior year, like I said, my knee started swelling up a lot, you know, because at UConn, Calhoun's into ice and stem, so it don't matter. You ain't getting no surgery. He don't believe in them surgeries,
right.
You know, which, you know, some people don't. But it got to the point, man, where after every practice, every game, my knee was swelled up, you know, like a big freaking tire.
Wow.
So we wind up, you know, going to the doctor, and the doctor said, you have a knee of a 62-year-old.
Yo.
And that right there was the most heartbreaking thing I think of I ever faced. I was just like, huh? He said, I don't think you got too much longer. And I'm like, you serious? He said, you have a little bit of cartilage left, which is barely anything.
So you practically bone on bone.
Bone on bone.
Wow.
So, you know, I went, I tried to rehab. I didn't rehab as hard as I could have on my own. You know what I'm saying? I was doing all the rehab with, you know, our fitness trainer, which was Bob. But
We know, human beings, we tend not to, when you go to like rehab, it's like you do it there, and then when you got to do it on your own, you're not doing much.
I just watched everything go sour as far as, you know, now the agents find out, you know, it's getting around, and I'm gonna be used goods overseas. Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying? So that's when, you know, me and Lappas started talking about, you know, hey, listen, I know this is tough. I don't think you're gonna be able to make it through your senior year, which I didn't, because the pain I was playing through practice, and they was noticing. They was like, yo, and I remember my first scrimmage game my senior year, man, and the pain was so bad. And I sat there, and he was just like, man, I don't think you could do it. He's like, but I want you to finish out and I want you to come on the coaching staff. But I was like, nah, I wasn't doing that.
Marcus!
You know what I'm saying? Which now, hindsight.
Now you're like, damn, I was an idiot.
Was great because he told me.
People don't get that.
And he told me I could keep you here and then get you to Philly Dickinson to get a. So this guy.
He was thinking ahead for you.
Yes. That's why I said I loved him because I was like, yo, this is the first guy where it wasn't about like straight basketball.
Like, make me look good as a coach. Yeah. Nah, he really cared about you as the individual.
So, you know, even though, you know, I got my associates and I'm 9 credits short, I still got close enough to get into the career I wanted to get into, which was criminal justice. You know what I'm saying? Which is a lot of jobs in criminal justice.
So, you know. We were talking off air a little bit and I'm a big advocate, and on this show, if you listen to it, you'll hear it over and over again. When an athlete, a basketball player in our case, makes it to a place where they earn a degree, earn a scholarship for the opportunity to earn a degree, that to me is like, yo, like you made it. Like pros and all of that is great. That's like gravy on top. But to me, it's like because it's so hard to get to college. For many people, right? To afford to go to college, right?
Student loans.
So, yo, it's insane.
I'm blessed.
Yeah. So, like, for you being 9 credits short, my man, like,
I know.
You almost made it.
Yeah.
Like, you're right there. You at the door.
Yeah.
Even if you got to come out of pocket at Harvard, maybe not Harvard, that's a little crazy. Yeah. But, like, 9 credits ain't crazy compared to 120 that you got to get, you know what I mean, in a normal school year or career.
Mm-hmm.
So, are you going to finish?
Yes.
All right.
Definitely.
Can we get a commitment date on the show?
I'm gonna give you about
you're not ready
2020-21
All right.
About 21. Give me the 21.
We give you a year and a half ish.
You know, and my wife is on me too because you know, like I said, she's going for her doctorates now and she just got her master's. So it's like I gotta pick it up.
you gotta get that look every night before she goes to bed. Give you the face
all the time.
Yo, but that's what's up, man. So so you're in the criminal justice field.
Yeah.
I mentioned earlier, so you work at a youth
detention Bridgeport Juvenile Detention in Bridgeport.
Got it. And you labeled it perfectly. I was trying to find out, like, what is that you do?
Yeah,
you
like, said you're like a juvenile CO.
Juvenile CO.
It's a juvenile detention officer, but we do the same thing, basically CO, except about weapons.
Right. So do the inmates there, the staff, do they know your history? Like, who you were growing up?
One thing you find out in the state, they take care of the athletes, especially CT. Like, you know, everybody in there is an ex-athlete. You know, it was a great one, you know, back in their time. So when I first got out of school, you know, that's the first thing. One of my cousin's best friends was a deputy supervisor there. He was like, man, one of the first things you're going to make sure is you got a career, you got a job. You know, you come home and you land back. Because I think everybody was like, he's letting it go?
Yeah.
Like, it's over? It was hard for people to look at me and be like, it's over. And it was a depression. It was a little depression, but it was just like, I'm the type of guy who always said, like, I'm going to get it some way. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to sit around if basketball don't work out, because I always thought about that, if basketball didn't work out, because I know players with injuries. And I had a lot of players that was with me that, you know, ended up in worse positions because, you know, they was basketball or bust.
Right.
You know what I mean? So for me, it was just like, nah, I got too many connections. I'm going to figure it out.
So your transition period was a lot shorter as far as the pain moving from only thinking about basketball to another career.
I wouldn't say it was shorter because even when I got into the gig, you still had people, oh, Marcus?
Like, what happened, Marcus?
Yeah, you know what I mean? So you still facing that, especially from your town. You know what I mean? So, you know, it kind of depressed me to the point where I just was working.
Thank you.
I stopped working out. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I wasn't going to the gym. I gained mad weight. You know, so come here.
Yeah.
I gained mad
weight. He's hilarious.
I gained mad weight, and so that part of my career was, part of my life became tough. You know, and then one day my father said, "Man, you know, what are you gonna do? You're not gonna give back. You're gonna sit around." You know what I'm saying? So he bought me a gym bag for my birthday. And I was just like, he was like, if you want to coach these kids, if you want to, he said, start looking like a player. Get yourself together. And I went back to the gym, started working out. Next thing you know, I'm playing little leagues, rehabbing my knee.
Yo, your father's a genius, B. Like, that was mad symbolic.
My father never missed a day at a gym in about 40 years.
Okay.
He's like a gym rat. Like, that's what he do.
So you talked about you being a CEO, a juvenile CEO.
Mm-hmm.
You said that in Connecticut, athletes that come through here get a lot of benefits, right? They get taken care of here in Connecticut.
I think, they take care of athletes, right? Definitely.
So in your job, how does that play out? Like, because inmates may not really know who you are. I don't know how old they are, because you know, people lose track of.
Well, it's being that, you know, we don't like to really call it a jail. It's more of residential services.
Okay.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah, because, I actually felt weird saying.
Yeah. I try to describe the job as that because, you know, it is still a locked facility.
Sure.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But we don't look at it like that. Like, it's a lot of stuff in place for these kids. It's almost, I'm not going to say kiddie land, but they make it not as bad to come in. I mean, there's still fights. You know,
sure.
Constantly. You still got the gangs and stuff like that. But, you know, I think New York might be a little tougher when it comes to that.
New York is like
down here.
New York is like jail.
Yeah, down here, we have more of a caring type also. You know what I mean? So we are allowed to bring, you know, I had a documentary in high school. So show the kids where I come from, who I am. And a lot of them relate with it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it makes your relationship a little better. And, you know, sometimes we even have programs where the kids come out and if they want to get into a basketball program, they can come to my camp. You know what I mean? The state will pay and stuff for it.
Okay.
So it's a lot of positivity going on in there.
That's dope.
Yeah. And that's what I started loving about the job, because you could move out and go probation. It's different areas, different spots you could move into. But I'm a hands-on guy. I love doing it with the kids. I love giving back. I love showing them. I have, you know, I enjoy work. I'm not going to lie. I mean, you got the, you know, they still watch you a lot because you're with kids.
Sure.
So you
got
to be careful.
Sure.
But I enjoy it, man. You see some talent in there. We had a kid the other day. He's nasty in football. We have another kid who's great in basketball. Some kids made it out. And everybody messes up when they're young. So some kids make a stop through. Then we had another kid. He was doing all types of crazy card tricks, pulling stuff out of his mouth like a magician.
Wow.
And you were out here like, there's so much talent out there. You know, and it starts with the kids.
Yeah.
You know,
100%.
That's the biggest thing.
So it's. I mean, I didn't know anything about it, so I'm glad you described how Connecticut handles that. Because a lot of times, as soon as you, and I'll say the system just for lack of a better term, but once kids or people get into trouble in some capacity and they're now registered in the system, and it's a really difficult thing for them not to continue down that path the way the system is designed.
That's right there. That's what will tangle you up and give you mixed reviews about the job.
Mm-hmm.
Because you watch these kids, they're giving them a lot of probation, and sometimes these kids have 18 month probation, they're turning 17, 18. So once they finish their program, they still on like 6 months probation. Now what happens once you violate? You cross over into
adulthood. Yeah, you.
So what I started noticing about this system is it's a billion-dollar system, but it's my people. They keep
of course
up in here. So I feel as though when you have people like me that can relate to these kids who come from the same areas, it gives them a chance. And it's sad because my little cousin was killed about 3 months ago, and. You know, he just made his mind up of the gang life. And I always say, once you choose that, I can't. Ain't too much I can do. You know what I mean? So I'm bringing them to the, you know, trying to get them jobs and showing them, having them come to my camp. And he knows the influence I have out here. And he just, you know, I was coming from North Carolina and he was shot and killed. You know what I'm saying? And
I'm sorry to hear that.
It was something that hurt me, but, it really hurt me. But I knew.
You were a little bit at peace with it.
Yeah, it's weird because I was just like, all right, it happened. That phone call was coming. It was coming.
Because you know he made his bed and that was kind of what he was trying to do.
Yeah, and you know, and when these kids, they understand when they get out here and they get active like that, man. We, you know, in my city is just notorious. You know what I mean? And it's crazy. People be like, oh, you live in Bridgeport? But Bridgeport has a lot of different things they're pushing towards.
Like every city.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But we, you know, it is tough out here too because we're losing lives. Like, two of my cousins that was beefing, my other little cousin got killed right after him. in retaliation for him getting killed because they were in two different gangs. So and they're damn near first cousins. Oh, so this is the type of dynamic.
Damn.
You get what I'm saying? But when you see that stuff front line, and we going to one funeral, and the other cousin getting chased down by his people because it was just like I've never seen. But this is the stuff that goes on. You get what I'm saying? So for me to be positive makes me extra positive, and it makes me extra motivated because my son's coming up as well. But giving back, and I love my city. I'm not gonna lie to you, like, and that was my problem in college. I love my city because my city showed me so much love, but it was to a fault.
You get what I'm saying? But
now it's getting better.
But now you get a chance to kind of redo it.
Stuff. Now I'm having fun with it, man. And you know, and recently, man, you know, we had a kid, man, and this kid was he was so good in ball, man. And then he got caught up in the shooting. And it was just like now his teammate and him are beefing. These are two kids that we had. So me and the coaches, we trying to do family stuff. We trying to just
try to smooth it out.
They at war right now. So when you see stuff like that, you like, damn, the influence of the impact of the city where you grow up at, the projects and stuff of where they're at, they're really representing this. Like, and you know, we watch it on, you know, with the rappers and everything. Like, they don't know this is an influence on these kids. Like, they repping their hood and their project. They dying for that.
Yep.
So, you know.
I had a guest on the show, actually a family. You might know them. Carl Nickerson Sr. is his name. Mm-hmm. New York coach, and his kids came through St. Raymond High School.
Mm-hmm.
He was constantly saying when he was on my show, the street is undefeated. Meaning, as soon as you pick that, You're not winning. And I don't know how many examples we need to see for it to make sense. Because you was a knucklehead. I was a knucklehead. We all grow up thinking we know more than anybody. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, there's real life lessons out there that all you got to do is open your window in places that we come from.
Yes.
And you could see it. Nobody got to draw it for you, tell you about it. Like, you see it right outside your window.
Yeah.
And it doesn't stick.
It's just like, you know, systematically is how it was designed. But the thing that I think that we should take is, even in your environment, it's so many, much more opportunity.
100%.
You understand?
100%. You just got to be open.
I think where it comes from is the adults.
Yeah.
Of helping these kids out. You know, you got so many adults trying to get the kids to do so much criminal activities or abuse them, manipulate them.
Yep.
That they don't got enough of us trying to do positive and teach them because they don't know what to do. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, we should be the ones that's teaching them, and we go through a lot of that now. You know, so.
So you just kind of going a little bit on a lighter note.
Yeah.
You talked about your involvement in the community.
Mm-hmm.
You have the New England Supreme Golf Tournament.
That
you started a couple years back.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Are you a golfer? Do you like golf?
You know what the crazy part is? And I'm not really a big golfer. I just started playing.
Okay.
Like, within the last few years. And I still play here and there. I love it when I do, when I learn the game. But I knew that golf is a socializing event.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people are into it. You know, so I thought about doing it. And when I did it, all these people came out. So, you know, I was able to raise some money.
Yep.
I made a great relationship with the golf course to do it there. It was a great turnout, man. People came out that I never thought would come out. So they want to make it bigger. You know, I've been on the phone with, like, you know, my guys like Richard Hamilton, Karan Butler, just different guys talking about the golfing. You know what I mean? Next year we tried to get Scott Burrell last year. So we just, you know, it's just a great networking.
It's awesome.
It's great.
So it's funny when you say you just got into it. Mm. Most people, when they get into it, especially like later in life, it becomes like this addiction.
Yes, yes.
You kind of start feeling like, oh, I need a club, blah, blah, blah. I had my small bout with that. I lived in Florida for a bit.
Uh-huh.
And I took a little course. And I, you know, for 2 days or what have you, just learning the basics.
Yeah.
Yo, I went out and bought clubs. Like, I'm not an impulsive type of buyer, but
yeah,
I was like, yo, I can do this. and I stopped.
Yeah, but one day. It's addictive, though.
It is.
Addictive. It is. Believe me, you know, it's addictive.
So you have this tournament, and the whole premise of it is to collect funds to provide for Bridgeport.
We did
it
for the Sheen Center and Taylor Center and a couple different community centers around town.
Got it.
You know, just, you know, I just think any type of donation that you're giving going towards these kids is going to help them in any way. You know what I mean? Because I understand that now. Of programming. We need programming, man. More programming. I preach it all the time. You know, it's when I was young, sports, after school programs, it was a must.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have that no more. I see these kids, what ain't nothing to do? You know, I'm going home. I'm trying to get some money. I'm smoke weed. I'm going to play the video game. And that's what pacifies our kids now, man. So, you know, I'm just trying to, you know, get the city back into a form of, you know, the city's getting better. It's a lot of stuff coming out here and money coming out here now. So,
yeah,
we're trying to get some stuff for the kids, you know.
That's dope. So you've had a lot going on in your basketball life.
Yeah.
Fortunately, you've had support. Your father, your uncle, people around you that seem solid, mm-hmm. that probably prevented you from going all the way left in certain cases.
Mm-hmm.
How do you see here in Connecticut the course that the kids have to take in order to try to achieve greatly in basketball? Like, do you feel like they have that kind of support? And what's the trajectory looking like?
I'm starting to see it. I mean, kids are going to school. We had a kid, Tremont Waters. He went to the Celtics. I think he had a great support system behind him. We had another kid, Mustafa Haram, who was doing well at St. John. So the support systems are here. I'm seeing more people come out, but I think it has to be more of an impact on education. I don't think that, you know, a lot of kids is going not making the grades. A lot of schools are passing kids, and it was like that when I was younger. But mm-hmm. now these colleges, we have a kid out here who was damn near All-American. We had no grades. I see them sitting out here. I'm like, what you doing? You ain't go to prep school? You ain't go to junior college? Nothing? Now I'm waiting on the school. I was going to sit out this year, take some classes. And they said I could take some classes to get my grades up. I used to tell them. Yeah, and that's how you get lost.
Of course.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I think, like, with my son, like I said, you know, we talk about sports all the time. I want him to go to, you know, I'm invested in education with him. I want him to go to good schools and get a great education. So I know, if his knees do go out or his body goes out, he has a brain and he could able to make a career and make some money out here and take care of his family.
So you're a Bridgeport guy, really close to New York.
Yeah.
How did you not get pulled into the New York basketball world? Because you were hot coming out of high school.
Mm-hmm.
Nationally ranked, you had all these accolades. What was it that prevented you? Because I'm sure, and you talked about it, but you have folks like Gauchos calling you,
mm-hmm.
you know, all sorts of AAU squads, schools,
get it.
And all of that. Mm-hmm. What prevented you from taking that jump and really getting deep in it?
Just want to stay home. Because to me, it was like, okay, I can go to ISA.
Yep.
Right? And I play with Brian Woodward, who was a popular kid out there, with my guy. And I played for this coach, Ron Nicleri. I don't know if you heard of Ron.
He was a guest on Dribble N Dimes.
That's my guy.
Yeah,
tell him
he's
myself
a man.
What's up.
He's a man.
Ron, me and I played with Royal Ivy.
Yep.
We all played together. But I was still that kid from Connecticut. You understand?
Yeah.
So I'm in New York, you know, and they talking about Brian 20 and, you know, but it's still like.
You felt out of place?
Not out of place, but I was still that CT kid.
But I'm saying.
Yeah, because it was.
Was that a chip on your shoulder because of that? Or did you feel
no,
like.
No, it was because these were my guys.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So I have fun. I didn't. Like, when I play with. Like, if I go out there, I play Andre Barrett. Or I go play with all the Kenny Satt. We chilling. I'm on the court because I know them. We balling. We, you know what I'm saying? I ain't have no problem taking a back seat. And people were going to talk about me regardless of how I played.
Right.
But I just felt like I was still CT.
Okay.
New York is strong. So when you come from New York, they talk about they want New York.
Sure.
You get what I'm saying?
I understand.
So me being not being from there, it was just like, I want to set my own down here. And then we'll go and play against New York. You get what I'm saying?
Build it up here.
Yeah, because okay. I felt like New York was New York. And because I'm not from out
there.
That's
not where you're from originally.
Yeah. And it's not, you know what I'm saying? It's just like, okay, yeah, that's that kid from CT. Oh, that's Cox, but he from CT. Just like that
you
kid. It's like that's Jason Williams, but he from Jersey.
Right. Yeah, you're right.
You know what I'm saying? And right. That's the feel I got. You know what I'm saying?
I respect that, though. It's funny because when we were putting this podcast together, the easy thing for me and my brother who do the show is like, all right, let's do New York because that's where we're from. That's more or less what we know. And a lot of our guests have been New York affiliated. But I wanted to challenge that because I don't look at New York basketball. When people talk New York basketball, New York style basketball, I include New Jersey and Connecticut because the influences are just so great.
It is.
And the styles are very similar. I look, you know, it's unfair to call. That's why I try to make sure we talk about it in the tri-state to include everybody, not like New York and then have y'all like, yo, UCT, but really, it's not fair.
Nah.
So, you know, and this is kind of my first real, like, foray, like, deep into the culture of Connecticut basketball, which is why I appreciate sitting with you so much. Because, like, you know, you think you know, right? And we have a conversation, and likely I'll have another conversation with somebody, and those conversations connect. So nicely because of the same background experiences.
Yeah.
So those are the stories I'm trying to collect because you don't hear too much. Like, you know whatever they wrote about you in the paper, right? And highlight stuff, but not really getting to know you
and the
things that you had to endure to get to a certain level of hoops.
That's true.
So that's what we're trying to do with this. So this is why I really appreciate you sitting with us. But... so that makes a lot of sense, right? You want to establish your own here.
Yeah, that was just my biggest thing, man. It was just like, you know, being from Bridgeport, we always felt that we was as good as New York, even when we played against them.
Yep.
From AAU tournaments to everything, you know what I'm saying? So
why wouldn't you?
It was just like I'm from CT, man. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, but we'll see y'all. We want to play y'all. You know, that's how it was. It wasn't like I wanted to, because I felt like when you take a kid from CT and you bring him to the city adopts you. Nobody even knows you're from CT no more. Am I right?
Facts.
Because we had a couple kids, man, that people thought they was from New York. And I'm like, nah, that kid from Waterbury. He's from me. And he's like, nah, he been playing with them for... And I'm like, that's what they do.
But see, this is my big... this is a contentious topic. Because, excuse me, back in the day, in your case, exactly. Yeah. You went to Kolbe your entire career. You didn't go to another school, prepped out somewhere else. Nah, you stayed consistent with the place you started at. I admire that. I miss that because you get to know a player, and high school is the most critical phase of that. You get to know a player, you see him coming up and gradually improving and starting to make a name for himself.
Yeah.
And then you have the neighborhoods, the city, so, you know, show that kid so much love. Yeah. That's when the coming of age kind of happens, right? And then the notoriety just starts spreading like wildfire from there in their town, in their city, potentially even their state. That to me, that creating that, like that, you're benefiting from that right now.
Definitely.
Had you gone to New York, probably not.
Same thing with UConn. Kansas, would I be able to come home and get felt by my hometown?
So that one I disagree with. I think you, because again, like you look at it from the grassroots level, high school, let's call that grassroots, right? You're so involved in the grassroots of high school is such a meaningful period of time, especially if you were like a hoops junkie. You got your high school teams that you're following in a particular area.
That's true.
And then especially when now think about it like this, right? You're at Kolbe, now you get national recognition and it's attracting attention to Kolbe. Your name is the headline associated with that, right? Now, you know the pride, people puffing up their chest. They never been to Kolbe.
But they're
like, yo, that's my team. That's my people's over there.
It was many, you know, many more great players that could start to come through there after me.
So like you could easily, had you gone to Kansas, you went to UMass, you come back to Bridgeport, all the love.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so like that to me is one of the issues I see, because you come out of your designated area, you go prep somewhere or what have you. Granted, for that kid, it's probably a life-changing experience.
Yeah.
I don't discount that.
Yeah.
But I think there's more, potentially more value for that individual. Well, I know kids, lifelong.
We see that all the time. We got kids that, you know, come from certain areas and they take them away and you don't even know that they from that area. You know what I mean? We had, for instance, the kids from our waters, you know, he gets taken out, goes to, I think, I forgot the prep school he went to, but he went to a good prep school. And then he decides, like, you know what, my senior year, since I already picked my school, I'm coming back to play home. And that right there told me that was big for him.
Yeah.
Just that he wants to play against the competition around him, his local competition. Right. And I thought that was great. I was like, I never seen that. Like, you just need the prep. Kent, matter of fact, Kent, prep school he went to. And when he came back, man, it was like an uproar. It was like, oh, he's going to play against Hillhouse and... You know, everybody got up, and I thought that was so dope.
That is dope. That's different. You don't hear that.
But a lot of kids get taken away, and then they wind up, even they go to the pros, they was taken away from us, so we don't know those kids. You know what I'm saying?
I had a famous Milbank coach. You probably know him. Oh, my God. I just drew a blank. He's going to kill me. It'll come to me. Anyhow, He came, like, the whole Jelly Fam, all them cats, like, he's been affiliated. He's been coaching those guys.
Yeah.
Mo Bamba was one of his.
Yeah, Mo Bamba, yeah.
He came out of Milbank originally. I blamed him when he was on the show. I was like, yo, it's your fault that I never heard of Mo Bamba until the NBA draft.
A lot of us did.
I know. And I told him.
When the kid made the rap about him. Remember
right. Shaq West, yeah.
That was like, oh, that's your boy? Exactly. Oh, he from where you from? Oh, shit.
Exactly.
Okay.
That's the kind of stuff that drives me insane because I'm like, man, like, you know how much I would love to, like, be supporting somebody like that?
No.
Like, really getting deep into it? Like, that to me is everything. But back to you, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Today, you have your camp. Is that a year-round thing? Like, how is that operating?
Yeah, we do it year-round. Most of the time, I do the summertime down in Bridgeport, and we have a top 40 camp where we take the top 40 players from Connecticut, and we have them play. You know, see, you know, have it's like a competitive camp we have. Yeah. People have been loving it for a while too.
It just hit me. His name is Coach Roosevelt Byers.
Rose Byers.
I'm so sorry, Coach. that's my man. That's my man now, and I spaced.
Because you are right now.
Like, I'm sorry, bro. Nice. I'm just, you know, parent life.
Yeah. But after that, in the summertime, you know, we're going to do our first season this summer of AAU.
Okay. How do you feel about that? How do you feel about AAU generally, and then why you're involved?
You know what it is? It's as much as we want to go against AAU, because it doesn't really make you better, but that's where all the competitive players are playing. And if it wasn't for AAU, I don't know how high I would have got ranked that early. You get what I'm saying? So AAU is a great tool to see the talent around the world. You know what I'm saying? Like, for me to get into the top 50, you know, coming out of my freshman year of high school, it gave me a lot of hype. You know what I mean? But it was because of playing against Lamar Odom and Rashad Lewis and freaking Ron Artest and Elton Brand. I mean, they squad, whatever Riverside squad was,
yeah,
like,
disgusting.
It had a shook. Like, Artest, Elton Brand, my boy Eric Barkley.
How did y'all play? How did y'all figure? What was the name of the team?
That was Riverside. We was the Sheen Center.
Okay.
And my freshman year, and I remember just seeing all these dudes, and Tavares Bell. And I just went out there, and, you know, we had a kid named Emmitt Saunders. Who went with me? I mean, Saunders at the time was ranked number 3 in the country. Kolbe Bryant was in the tournament. The other kid that went to Duke and left Duke, the big white center, I forgot his name. I know. We went there. I think it was Chris Burgess.
Okay.
We went there and I walked in the gym and Kolbe had did like a crazy 360 and I was like, oh shoot, I see all these coaches and all the players and I'm like, this is what it's about right here. You know what I'm saying? So that tournament, Emmitt wound up getting some squabbles with the coach. He left us and went to another team.
Uh-huh.
And the coach said, hey, it's on you. You better come on here. Where we want to play? He ain't here. Now, mind you, we got all these scouts coming because he's number 3 in the country. He's doing Slam Diary.
Right.
And, you know, he put me on the team with him. I came out there, and he had left. And I'm like, you going to leave me on the team? And he's like, man, I'm out. I can't play for him. I went crazy. You know?
Because you knew. This was like, yo, this is a big look.
Kid named DeMar Johnson. Which played me in ABCD, and I went ham, and they was just like, as you know, I'm being written about. Hey, this newcomer came in. We ain't never seen this kid. He's gonna, you know what I mean? And it started. But, you know, that AAU could be, it's tough too with playing all that summer ball. But at the same time, you definitely need to work out. You have to work out. You can't just play AAU the whole summer. But we're going to invest in and try this summer because we got a lot of kids out here. We want to get out, you know.
Yeah.
And then in the wintertime, I'm a private sector in Weston, Connecticut. We do their whole winter AAU. My company has a management agreement with them. So
We
run there. It's great because we get to put our people on with jobs. You know what I'm saying? So they could become coaches and make a little bit of money. You know what I'm saying?
And help out.
So creating jobs. So, you know, I look at it as, hey, you know, if I went to the NBA, I could take care of everybody, but you still could help people out and take care of your people with business and making the right decision.
So you see it often. I'm sure at this point in your life, you look at it, and if you had made it to the NBA, you'd probably be similar to everybody else. Like you're going to be giving people a cut of your money.
I'd be broke. My mother said it. My mother said, everybody has everybody's life is written, she feels. And she was like, I don't think that was in the cards for you, because I think that you would have tried to help too many people out.
But it's the natural thing. But now you're in a position where you're teaching people how to fish.
Yes.
So you put them in position, now you got to sink or swim, bro.
Yes.
The more you swim, the more bank
and
you
make. And that's the thing that you start learning. Because you'd be like, if I was in the NBA, I would have just been...
Yes.
Now I'm like, what you gonna do with that? How are we gonna make this work?
I'm gonna open this door for you, bro.
Yeah, you gotta go do it. It's even people have taken the proper steps just to get in. Like, you gotta do a background check. You gotta do a concussion training. I've had people that can't even get through those two steps.
An easy decision at that point. It's on you, bro.
So now it's like, all right, next, who else wanna do it? You got somebody else?
Who's next on the list?
You know, and you don't feel too bad because you like, listen, man, you got to help yourself. And you find out it's givers and takers in the world, man. I'm starting to find that out now.
Hey, yo, bro, there's people that go through life and never find it out. So never. Be thankful.
Mm-hmm.
What is one of the major highlights that you've experienced as a player?
The major highlights?
Well, something that comes to mind that you're just like, damn, that was a great day. Or a great game.
Okay, I'm going to say we played in... it was in Chicago Bulls Arena.
Okay, United Center?
United Center, and played against, might have been Duke or North Carolina, and...
This is when you was at UConn?
Yeah. We flew back on the Chicago Bulls jet. And to me, that was, like, amazing. Like, sitting in Jordan's seat, they showing us around the jet, and where they played cards at. And I thought that was, like, crazy.
That was, like, a Calhoun hookup? Like, cool with them cats.
Must have been Calhoun hookup. We were so spoiled back then.
Yeah,
because,
yeah,
you know, just coming off a championship, you got pros going in. We went to Nike Town, man. They was just giving us stuff.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Eating it up, bro.
There's people to this day that I gave some, that still tell me how much stuff I gave them. I don't remember. I was coming home.
You just get so much gear.
And then when Rip went to go play with Jordan, he would take care of me and my roommate Tone and Khalid and a couple of us on the team. We had all the Jordans before they came out. So we on TV playing against Arizona with the patent leather grays. And people calling me, like, I was looking at my phone. Yo, my God, how you good? You know what I mean?
So, you killing me right now.
Yeah, so it was a lot of, like, you know, amenities we got at UConn, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, and it's, I got one more highlight. The other highlight of my career was at UMass. And it was my homecoming. We used to play against UConn. And when I went out there, they was booing us so bad. It was Okafor, Ben Gordon, Talik, Tone, all my boys is there. And we was up 29-8 at halftime.
Yo.
And I had the whole arena.
You had 27 of those 28 points.
Nah, I finished up about 13.
Okay.
But I had like 9 rebounds, almost triple-double. You know, we played great. Micah started out killing. I had Micah going crazy. We had this kid Jackie. Jackie started out good. You know, Lappas is like, they locked us out the locker room. We couldn't get in the locker room. Lappas is going crazy. They can't stop us. Nothing can stop us. But he told us to hold the ball. He wanted to win so bad. Because
he wanted to slow the pace down.
And I told him, coach, I don't know.
That's not the rhythm that I was playing.
We slowed the pace down. We slowed the pace down, and I knew it was over as soon as.
Damn! I was hoping this was gonna be a happy ending.
Michael was like halfway down, about to duck. Okafor just came and smashed it. And then the arena went crazy. Now Ben hitting threes. We had a kid named Rashad Anderson who wasn't even in the scouting report who knocked down like about 7-8 threes on us. And they wound up beating us by about 8 or 9. But it was like, you know, it was a moment though. That it was
first
like
half was
damn, like we like, you know, like this is perfect right now, you know? So
damn.
I'm like 2 moments.
How about your low light? I think we probably touched on a couple of them, but
I'm gonna say probably my junior year when I found out that day at the doctor that my knee was had a knee of a 62-year-old, and you know my knee was so bad and basketball was gonna be over. I think that became a low point because I almost actually just gave up on sports, you know, period. Like I didn't want to work, not even just working out, you know what I mean? So that was a very depressing moment, you know, to find out that, you know, even like you leaving your baby, man, it's over, man. We had a nice ride.
Yeah.
But guess what? For, you know, for it to be real, for us to play right now, it's going to be over. So, I think then.
Brother, this was fun. I really appreciate having you welcome me into your home, first and foremost, because not something I take lightly.
Yeah.
if you could speak to your former self, what would you tell yourself that might make a difference in where you are today?
Like Calhoun said one thing to me that stuck with me. If you're not mentally tough, you should basically blow your brains out. And he said that because life throws so many curves that you gotta try to be as mentally tough as possible to make your way get through stuff. I'm not talking about mental illness or anything.
No,
I'm just talking about being mentally tough.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I tell the kids that now. It starts with here, because if you can't get through obstacles in life, you know, and back then I wasn't mentally tough at all.
Okay.
You know, I was one to space out. So I would tell myself, my old self, be more patient, have been more patient, you know, like I'm going to tell him. And to listen. You know, as young people, we don't listen.
No, we don't.
We quick to go against you quick. So
That's exactly what we do. You tell us to go left, we going right. It's the truth, man.
Listening is the key. So I think if I changed some of them things, I probably would have been probably just in basketball a little further. You know, not in life. I'm happy where I'm at now.
Okay.
But I think I would have been further with basketball.
That's dope, brother. Yo, again, thank you so much. It's another wonderful episode of Dribble N Dimes. Thank you to Mr. Marcus Cox and his lovely wife that isn't here, but definitely had to give him the green light to allow me in this mug. And to young little Cox over here, who was a great co-host today. Yeah! Get it, boy!
Say yeah, yeah.
Say yeah! Yeah. All right, y'all. Peace. Thank you for listening to this episode of Dribble N Dimes. If you like what you heard, please leave a review or comment wherever you're listening to us now. Check us out on social media as well. We're live on Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. On all platforms, you can find us at DribbleNDimes.